PanPastels and Sofft Tools are my products of choice today, and I'm working with them in an art journal, using several techniques for backgrounds with stencils and stamped images. So PanPastels, Sofft Tools, Sofft Sponges, that's what I'm going to work with today. At their most basic, a pastel is nothing more than a powdered pigment put together with some sort of a binder, and typically you'll see them in a stick form. A PanPastel is a very similar product, however, that powdered pigment is put together with minimal amounts of binders, minimal amounts of fillers. They're packed into the pans that you see here, and because they're very soft, they are actually quite blendable. You can do lots of different things with them. Now, pastels by their nature are not permanent. They require some sort of fixative. I have read and seen people who use things like hairspray, which I will stay away from. It's not archival, it's liable to yellow over time. You have no idea what's in there. What I'm going to show you and what I've been using is this SpectraFix. You can see that it's a pump sprayer. It's not an aerosol, which I really like. Now, it's going to take several very light coats to get some fixing action from this. You have to kind of be patient with it. You can hurry the drying process along with a heat tool. It's going to require probably 3 to 4 very light coats before you could come in with a paper towel, rub it across the surface, and see very minimal lifting of color. You're never going to make this 100% permanent unless you encase it in something like gel medium or a clear gesso, something like that. And there are ways to do that. We're not going to talk about that today. For today, we're just going to go ahead and stick with this SpectraFix. So I'm going to show you ways or a way to create a really simple background. Now you'll notice on the Sofft Tools that I have color on both sides. That's because I like to flip the cover over and change colors, and it allows me to use one tool kind of easily with two colors. So these, because I'm not a fine artist, and there are plenty of ways to use these if you are, but for my purposes they're almost interchangeable, although obviously the pointy tool is nice to get into little tiny places. So I'm just going to work with that tool. I'm going to grab one of these sponges. There are lots of different styles and sizes of sponges available. There are different kinds of applicators, lots of different ways that you can apply this. I'm not going to use my fingers. It actually does, the PanPastels don't work really well with your fingers, so I'm going to stay away from that. So I have, what do I have here? Hansi yellow, this is magenta, and this is one of the metallic colors. It is copper. I'm going to start with yellow in the center. I'm going to kind of blend out to the magenta along the outside edge of the, or the outside border area, and then I'm going to bring in some copper just because I like metallic, and why wouldn't I? So I'm going to start with this. I'm just going to, I find it easier. If I do this, I find that the sponge kind of goes off in all directions. I find it easier to kind of fold it up so that I'm working with just a small part of it. And I'm just going to very lightly stroke on this color. It's only a couple of dabs across the pastel in the jar at a time for me. Otherwise, I find that I get too much color and I find it a little bit harder to control. You can, of course, experiment and find what works for you. So this looks pretty good. I'm just going to get some color, as I said, kind of in the middle. Now I'm going to come in, which of these tools? This is the tool that actually has the magenta on it. So I'm just going to pick up the littlest bit of magenta and I'm going to start blending it in along the edges here. Now, I'm not being particularly careful about how much I do or don't blend. You can actually spend quite a bit of time and blend this quite a lot if you want. I'm just kind of playing around here. Excuse me, here. I'm going to make the edges darker. And then I'm going to kind of feather the color in so it gets lighter as it comes in toward the yellow. And one of the things that you'll see is that I can come back with the yellow and I can kind of soften that blend so it is a little bit more subtle than what you see. You don't have to. There are lots of times that I'll do art pages where the colors are, or art journal pages rather, where the colors are very jaggedy and not super blended. It's just a matter of preference. Alright, so that looks pretty good. Let's come back with the yellow and this other sponge. Now I'm going to get color on my finger and it will move as I kind of work with it, so you need to bear that in mind. You have to almost change your expectations when you work with PanPastels. They are a very different beast. They're wonderful, but you need to think about them and work with them, change your mindset so that you're not thinking about how paint would react with them or how paint would react if you used it in this way. All right, so let's bring some yellow out to the edge, maybe just to make this look a little bit different. Just try a little bit of this. And now I'm going to grab, I think this is the soft tool that I was using the copper with. I'm just going to stroke it on there, and now I'm going to kind of blend it in. And it's going to help soften these colors a little bit. In fact, I think I'm going to actually just sort of tone down all of that yellow a little bit by running the copper over the center. All right, so this is kind of good enough at this point. I'm not trying to make great art here. I just want to sort of explain how you can get these colors applied. If I want to come back with a little bit more yellow and just kind of maybe soften those blends in the center and emphasize the yellow a little bit more, I can certainly do that. So now it's time to think about fixing. So I'm going to show you, now if you are sensitive to smells, to odors, then you should do this in a well-ventilated place or do it outdoors. I find that this product actually has a really mild scent. It does not offend me. I'm indoors, I'm going to spray this indoors. What I am going to do is just grab a piece of paper to try to contain the spray from that edge. So this is how I fix this, and I'm going to do this probably 3 or 4 times anyway. That's kind of my first coat. I need to let this dry, and I'm going to do this 2 or 3 more times, and that will help kind of fix that color in place so it's not so smudgy, so that I'm not going to pick it up on my fingertips, and it means I can come and put things over the top of it, and I'm going to get layers rather than blending. There are now 4 coats on this background, and the process was very straightforward. You saw me spritz the first coat on, I brought out my heat tool and I dried it, and then I just kept doing that, drying and putting another coat on until I had a total of 4. And what I want to show you now is a couple of things. The first one is that this is much less smudgeable now than it was, but more importantly, you can still see the glimmer from the copper color that I put on there. It does tone it down a little bit, but it doesn't remove all of the glimmer. And I want to show you that you can stamp on this spread and spray on this spread the same way that you would as if you hadn't put anything on here at all. So let's back up 1 second. This is something where I just kind of played and laid some color down. And if I grab a piece of paper towel, you'll see that if I come in here and I rub this, you're going to see a fair amount of pink. But if I grab another spot on here and I rub this on here, you're going to see far less color come off. This is why I say you're never going to really make it truly permanent, but you can really calm that down a lot. All right, so now that you've seen that page, I've just got some painter's tape in here so that I can kind of hold these pages down and they're not lifting all over the place, making me crazy. So let's talk for a second, about stamping. This is one of our Doodle Flower stamps. This is one of the newer colors in the Ranger Archival ink. This is called Cactus Flower. It's a really pretty, vibrant pink. So all I'm going to do is, if I wanted to put some texture and some interesting things on this page, I would just come and I would press this stamp down. It just makes a layer, and art journaling is really, I find it very important to have layers. I think the more layers you have, often the more interesting things are, so this is just a quick way of adding some layers. Let's just stick that there. And you can see that there's absolutely no problem. This is archival. I could use Stazon. I could come in and use Distress. It really doesn't make a darn bit of difference. They're all going to work. So, same thing. I can bring in a stencil, and you'll see that I can lay this on here and spritz through it, and I'm going to, again, have no reaction. Unlike if you gesso or sealed this surface with something else, where a spray or other kind of liquid would beat up on it. That is not the case here at all. This is going to absorb right in the same way as it would with anything else that you sprayed it on where there was the page hadn't been treated or anything. So let me just go ahead and I think I'll print that little bit that's left on the stencil kind of down there just to add a little bit more texture. So again, the same thing. I would come back with my heat tool and I would go ahead and dry this. And now I have this spread ready to go. I could add some more layers if I wanted. I could come in and put some white paint on here. I could put some dots on, which I think I'll probably do. I can either use our dotted grid stencil for that and some white paint, or I could use one of the mini ink blending tools, which is round, and I could just kind of squish some circles on there. But you can see that when you put the pan pastels on and you fix them with the SpectraFix, it gives you a surface that's beautiful to work on. I did go ahead and put white dots on that page spread, and while it's off to the side drying, let me show you the wonders of working with Versamark ink and PanPastels. These are both 6x6 black Strathmore artist tiles, and you can see how dramatic the pearlescence and the metallics are on them. There's reflection, there's glimmer, there's shine. Here I use the pearlescent red and copper, and here I honestly don't remember. I want to say it was a combination of copper, pearlescent red, and probably some gold. The thing with this is that the Versamark ink stays tacky, and it will absolutely attract the PanPastels. And even though I had color spread all over these, you can brush off all that excess, because again, it's not permanent, and you can use that to your advantage sometime. So here is a 6x6 artist tile. I'm just going to grab a stamp. This is Margaret Applin's Vintage Correspondence stamp. So I'm just going to go ahead and put it on a block and show you how easy this is. So this is a little smidge big for this block, but it's close enough. So the thing with Versamark ink, and I've already got some PanPastel in here, the thing with Versamark ink is that it's sticky. It's a watermark ink, and so what I'm going to do is just put it on here and take advantage of that tackiness and let it adhere the PanPastel in place. All right. So if I hold this up to the light, you can see it reflecting off of the Versamark ink. This time I'm going to bring in, I have pearlescent purple and I have pearlescent blue. And let's see what else I have here. I have some pearlescent silver. So let's bring in these three colors. Let's get these out of the way. Now you'll notice, before I go too far, you'll notice that this got dropped and it shattered. Doesn't mean that you can't use it. It just means that it's a little bit of a pain to use. So you're just going to pick it up on the tool like this, smear it around, and I guess I'm going to use some pearlescent red on this. But I did want to show you that if this happens to yours, it's no big deal. There's no way to reconstitute this and sort of bring it back to this cake-like form, but you can still use it. It really isn't that big a deal. All right, so now let's bring in some other tools. That one's pink. Let's go ahead and bring in some of the pearlescent purple and go ahead and put that, go ahead and put that on various places. And then I will bring in some of the blue. And you'll see that this works perfectly. The watermark ink that is Versamark just grabs that color and holds it in place. I think I'll bring back some pink just because I can. I've got some sitting here anyway, so let's put some there. Now here's where the magic happens. I've got all of the ink has been covered with PanPastel. So let me go ahead and grab a piece of clean paper towel. And I'm just going to brush this off now. Now, I got a little smear there because I did not cover the ink properly, but you can see that by the time you get through with this, there's virtually no pastel left any place but where you might have smudged it with your finger, or in fact where the watermark, the Versamark watermark ink was. So then you're thinking, well, all right, well, what can I do with this? Well, this, and here's one that I did with just copper. This would make a wonderful card base. You can cut this out and you can layer some elements over it, or you can do some other fun things with it. For example, this is, again, this was this Vintage Correspondence stamp, and I stamped it several times on this piece, and then I just come in with a hole punch and I punch it out. So, and I have them in various sizes, from really small up to as much as, I want to say, close to 2 inches. All right, so let's bring this spread in, which is now almost dry. And you can see that I've got my white dots on here. It's something I really like to do. But if I wanted to come in, and let's grab one of these big ones. Let's say I wanted to layer some of these on there. Now this is facing you, so I'm going to kind of turn the text toward you. But I could come in and I could layer these on here, and because I used kind of those same warm colors, it works really, really well with this background that we created a few minutes ago. I can kind of bring in some of the smaller ones too if I want. You know, so there's lots of different ways that you can use these kinds of things. Now the other thing that I want to show you is that you can use the Versamark ink with a stencil. So let me grab a stencil. And let me grab, this is one of the 6x6 artist tiles, but this time it's in white. So this is one of the mini ink blending tools, and I have dedicated this particular sponge on it, this foam on it, to Versamark ink. So all I'm going to do, now I'm not going to do all of these, I'll just kind of come in and do a little bit here. It's just the technique, you don't need to see tons of this. I'm just going to pounce this straight up and down through the openings on a stencil. Very easy. You just have to take a moment to actually, you know, get the ink through the openings in the stencil, and then this technique will work beautifully. And just as I did on the black, if I want to blend colors on here, I can do that too. So I think I'll bring back the pearlescent red. And someplace here I had some orange, although I don't know if I can actually put my hands on it at this moment. Alright, so I don't know if I've gone completely through there, but as I look at an angle, it looks like I can see some reflection of light, so there must be enough on there. So in comes, like I said, I had some orange here. I'll be darned if I can remember where it is, but let's bring back the pearlescent red. Let's bring back this bright yellow, and we'll bring in some of the magenta. So working with tools, now here's the thing. I accidentally put purple on here. I wasn't paying attention. If you want to clean the soft tools, just brush them from side to side on a piece of paper towel, and that will pretty much remove most of the color. So I'll use that there. I have this for the magenta, and here's the other thing. Just turn this over, and now I have a perfectly clean foam that I can use on this yellow. And these little sponges are washable, so you can wash them out and reuse them. All right, so let's start with the yellow, since these are sunflowers. Seems kind of appropriate. And you can see where the Versamark ink is. It's grabbing that color right away. Same thing as when I stamped. Where is it? There it is. The difference now is that I have larger areas because the openings on this stencil were a pretty good size. So let's come back. Again, this is kind of a pain in the neck, but not impossible to work with. Let's brush some of that on here. How pretty is that? That pearlescent color is just marvelous. Touch some in here. Now obviously I didn't do the whole stencil. And then this magenta is a pretty deep color, so I'm not even going to dip into the pot until I absolutely have to. Let's just put a little bit on here. Now if I want to come back and blend this a little bit, I can certainly do that. I can darken it. I can pick up some more of the pearlescent red and smooth that color on there. And obviously you need to put enough of the product on so that you absorb, or you absorb into all of the tackiness from the watermark ink. You want to make certain that you do that. Otherwise, you're going to be left with a sticky spot that will pick up pretty much anything else that you throw at it. So again, let's find a reasonably clean piece of paper towel. Now, I'm not going to get all of this off. That's the thing about pan pastel. Even though this is Bristol paper, you can see, and all I would do would be to come back and just color the entire background so that I don't end up with these kind of weird white spots. But the thing with pan pastel is they're so soft, and when you use these tools, it really does push the product right down into the tooth of the paper. And this is Bristol. Even a paper like Bristol that really doesn't have a ton of tooth, it really does go ahead and adhere. Now, if I wanted to be certain that this wasn't going to move, obviously I'd come back with the fixative, with the SpectraFix, and I would go ahead and spritz this in probably 3 or 4 really light layers, depending on what my purpose was when I used it. So, you know, as you've seen, there's lots of different ways to use this. Now, the one thing that I want to do, I want to grab this journal page. Now that I know that it's dry, I want to come back and I want to show you that even though this has pan pastel and even though this has fixative on it, my pens work beautifully on here. I did go ahead and adhere some of those black circles that I showed you a few moments ago. I kind of like the way that this looks, so I'm going to actually pull this all together with some more black. I've gone around the edge with, this was a fine tip pit pen, and as I'll show you, the pens work beautifully on here. It doesn't make a darn bit of difference. This is my new thing. I'm just kind of doing straight lines like this. It doesn't make a darn bit of difference about the SpectraFix. It works just fine. The pit pens work. The Sharpie water-based paint pens work. I'm going to guess that pretty much any other pen that you would ordinarily use will also work. So you see that there's no problem there at all. If I want to come in and, let's see if I can, I can't do this and talk, so I'm not going to talk. All right, so that was a mess, but I find that the black kind of unifies things. Some days my hands work better at this than others. This is one of them where no matter what I do, they don't want to work particularly well. Just kind of go around here. But again, I think that the black acts kind of as a unifying element. It pulls everything together. I come down here and do these two down here. Of course, it doesn't help that the circles are not circular, nor are they particularly smooth because of the way I put the gesso on through the openings in the stencil. But it's done. Working with, again, with the Sharpie water-based paint pens, if I wanted to come in and let's say I wanted to just dot around the edge of these. Now, obviously, I'm working on that paper that had the Versamark on it and then had the pan pastel applied over, and you can see that there's no difficulty with that either. And if I want to come in and I want to dot around these white ones where I circled them with the black, again, the Sharpie water-based paint pens have no difficulty at all with the Spectrafix or the pan pastels on that background. So this is just kind of the beginning. I'm certain that there will be some more videos about pan pastel, but in terms of just getting started and seeing how they work for your basic art journaling and mixed media stuff, I'd say that they're a huge hit.